Hey, this is David, pastor of Hamilton Life, and I want to thank you for taking a listen to our podcast. For more information on our church and how you can support the ministry, you can visit us online at hamiltonlifechurch.com. Thanks again for taking a listen, and we hope you enjoy the podcast. Been in a situation where you felt like something needed to be done. Maybe you're in an office space and you're at a toner and you thought, man, the toner person should change the toner. Or you're in a community and someone needs a ride and you're like, man, the person who gives rides should give that person a ride. Maybe you're in a place and you're like, man, somebody should really step in and do something. Maybe it's not local, maybe it's a global situation where you look at a global situation and you think, why can't God do something? Why hasn't God just stepped in and changed a situation or changed a problem or changed an issue? And I find myself all the time going, man, somebody should do something about that. And what I've noticed is that typically when I recognize that someone should do something about something, that person is generally the person who's recognized the issue. In short, that person is usually me. What I do often is I go, man, somebody should do something about it. And in reality, I'm not somebody. And even though I never feel equipped or feel like I'm capable or feel like I'm able, generally, if I've found a problem, I'm the one who's supposed to step in and help solve that problem. Now, when it comes to God, we often say, why hasn't God stepped in? Why hasn't God changed the situation? And what I believe to be true is that more often than not, if we're sitting around waiting for God to do something, God is most often waiting for us to move so he can do his thing through us. And that a lot of times God's not waiting for resources, he's waiting for availability, he's waiting for people, he's waiting for us to humble ourselves and step into the place of action. And that's where we want to step in and talk about being marked by love. Marked by love is a conversation we started last week. And we answered the question, or sought to answer the question, how has love changed you? And last week we stood on this declaration that we have been marked by love, and we read this passage together. And so I want to invite you to read this along with me in 1 Corinthians 13:13. And we'll read this together if you will. Now these three things remain. Are you guys reading it too? I didn't hear you. All right, here we go again. Now these three things remain. Just so we're clear, we're reading this together, right? So now these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is hope. The greatest of these is faith. Now the greatest of these is what? The greatest of these is love. How has love changed you? We looked at the reality that God meets you where you are, but he doesn't leave you where he found you. That God changes us from the inside out, and that change becomes manifest in our actions. See, a lot of us were content with changing, but we don't want to do anything with that change. And God doesn't just find us in our mess. He wants to draw us out of our mess. That love changes us. So this morning, what I want to do is I want to answer this question. How has love moved you? How has love moved you? Because here's what I've found, at least in my life, is that if love has changed us, that change should be manifest in our actions. The reality is a lot of us are a reflection of change, but we haven't allowed that to translate into what we do physically and how we move. So how has love moved you? How has it moved you? And what has it moved you to do? That I believe this about love is that love always leads us to take another step. Anybody in a relationship right now, girlfriend, boyfriend? Okay. Anybody in a fiance relationship type thing, like almost about to, yeah. Anybody already married in the room? Yeah. So here's what's interesting, is that if you're in a relationship, anybody single? Just, okay, look around. Just quickly look around. All right, I just wanted to help you guys out, Lee Band. The idea here is that that what happens in a relationship is it starts with a friendship, it should, and then it moves into a relationship where you start dating, and then what's the next step? Engagement, yes. Well, engagement, then marriage, yes. Those are both correct in that order. The idea is that in love, in a physical relationship with a human being, that love moves us to take that next step. In a relationship with God, what's interesting is that we maybe not know who God is or not understand the impact that his love has made on our world. And so we end up understanding love at a certain level, but that love doesn't just change us, but it moves us. So all of a sudden, our love for God starts being manifest in the way that we volunteer, in the way that we treat one another, in the way that we give through our tithing or through supports of community outreach, our love begins to be manifested because love always moves us. There's stages, there's steps, there's movement, and love is always moving us. It's compelling us. It's driving us, and that's what God does, is he doesn't leave you where he finds you, but he compels you to live the life of more. And last week, we looked at John 21, and we talked about the fact that Jesus found several of his disciples fishing, and he called them to minister, called them to follow him. And then after Jesus had passed away and came back to life, or was crucified and came back to life, he finds several of his disciples fishing again. And it appears as if they had settled back into their old life, but Jesus once again decides to call and compel them to more. And I believe right here in this space, right now, God wants to compel you to more. That the life that God is inviting you to live is bigger than you ever imagined. That he wants to invite you to more because that's what love does. It moves us to action. That we often talk about love as a feeling or an emotion. Some of you, it's coming up on Valentine's Day. You're feeling it. Some of you are feeling the pressure. Some of you are feeling the anger. Either way, we know love as a feeling, an emotion, an experience. But what we don't always recognize is love as an action. And I saw this manifest in my life in several ways, but the most impactful way was last Tuesday. I was driving home, and it was about 5 o'clock. I walked in the door, and you know, I have this quintessential life where all the kids are just so happy to see me, and the house is perfect. My wife has, you know, everything taken care of, and you can smell dinner. It's just an ideal life. And I walk in, and I get a text message as I walk into my ideal life, and it says, "Do you want to go to the Kentucky Vanderbilt game tonight in Nashville?" I looked at my clock, and I said, "Absolutely." And it was from Aaron Allison. His daughter was leading worship with us this morning. This is the trade-off. You got to lead, and I got the tickets. And we're even now. Just tell your dad, stop harassing me. The idea is that he said, "Hey, I got two tickets." I'm like, "Oh, man, which is my favorite kid?" Like, I knew I was going to have to pick at some point, you know, that sort of drowning scenario, but I wasn't sure I was going to have to be right there. So I'm like, who do I love the most, and who's going to be disappointed? And right as I was about to make one of my kids angry and in therapy for life, he texts me back, and he says, "Don't worry about it. I got all three tickets." Yeah, no, we should clap. No, don't. So the idea was that it's 5:30 at this point. The game is, I think, at 9 o'clock. And so I'm like, okay, I'm doing the math. I'm like, let's just go. We pack up and we take off. And we're in the car on the way to Nashville to the boys for their first time experiencing, you know, the greatness of the Kentucky basketball. And so we're heading there. And all of a sudden it hits me. I actually have a busy day tomorrow. Like, how's that going to work? I'm not going to get back till really late. We might even stay the night, depending on how it goes. I got to cancel stuff, so I start calling up. I'm canceling my dentist appointment. I'm leaving him a voicemail saying, "Hey, something came up." You know what I mean? Because it did. I didn't lie. Something came up. I might have even said something important came up. And I said, "I can't make it. I apologize. We'll reschedule sometime." I had a lunch with a person in our community, a guy in our community. It was Jamie. And I called Jamie up, and I'm like, "Hey, Jamie, I got to cancel. I think we just do that by text." I'm like, "I'm out. I'm sorry. I'm busy. Something came up." You know what I mean? He would understand. The idea was I dropped everything and cleared everything because love moved me to action. And you've done the same in your life. It doesn't always have to be spiritual. You've moved by love in your own life. That love doesn't leave us where it finds us, but it moves us to something more compelling. And what I've found about love, at least in my own life, is that as we talk about love as an action, as something that moves us, we realize that the enemy of love is often conformity or comfort. That what I do naturally, my brain naturally goes to a place where I'm comfortable, where it's convenient for me. And what happens is every time I slide into this convenience or comfort, I realize that I'm vulnerable to the enemy. That every time that I realize I slide into this apathetic mindset, that the enemy ends up finding me, laying around doing nothing. That when love finds us apathetic, then we become vulnerable and susceptible. And I think that the problem is that a lot of us think that the opposite of love is hate. In fact, you may have even walked into this room thinking that the opposite of love is hate. That just makes sense. There's love and there's hate. But the opposite of love is not actually hate. It's indifference. It's apathy. Hate can't be the opposite because love actually creates a great emotion and takes a lot of effort and energy. And so does hate, if you think about it. If you hate someone in this room, it takes a lot of energy. It takes a lot of work to muster up hate. But the opposite of love is actually indifference and apathy. And so many of us don't understand. We don't have hate in our hearts, but we're apathetic people. And you can't be apathetic in a situation with love. That love does not leave you indifferent, that it challenges you and it changes you. And I feel like when I'm comfortable, I'm vulnerable, and what God is doing is inside of me, deep inside, because that's what love does, is love changes us first. It inspires us, and it sets a fire to our souls. And once we fall in love with God again, he begins to move us to fall in love with others, but he doesn't leave us indifferent. He doesn't leave us apathetic. And in John 21, we find Jesus, he's again having this encounter with the disciples. Last week we talked about the fact that he called them out of fishing to follow him, and then he walked through his time of ministry, and then he was crucified, and then he comes back, and he finds them fishing. They didn't catch anything if you were here last week or you read the scripture, and so he put the net on the other side, and the most obvious solution, they pull in 153 fish, and then Jesus said, come on, let's have breakfast. And we pick up the story in verse 12 of John 21. It says, come and have breakfast, Jesus told them. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. And just as a side note, I thought this was odd, and so I did a little research. And maybe this was obvious to you, but it wasn't obvious to me. Many smart people believe that the reason they didn't recognize Jesus immediately was because he was crucified. And before he was crucified, he was beaten and he was bruised. And because he was human, there's a really good chance he didn't just supernaturally heal, even though he came back to life. There's a good chance he was almost unrecognizable at this state. Now, it's not scripture, but it's theory and theology and possibility. But the idea was that none of them dared to ask because they knew there was something about him, that they knew it was Jesus. In verse 13, Jesus came and he took the bread and he gave it to them. And he did the same with the fish. And this was now the third time that Jesus had appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. And when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Now, there's a lot to unpack in the life of Simon. A lot to unpack that I believe could help us understand how we relate to God as well. But setting the scene, we find that Jesus is wrapping up this really great breakfast. There's no better meal. It's breakfast. And they're having breakfast. And Jesus is finishing up breakfast. And there's several disciples sitting around. And my guess is that in front of everyone, he could have had a sidebar, but my guess is in front of everyone, he says, hey, Simon, do you love me more than these? I think this is odd. And I put myself in the old situation where what if we were in a room full of people and I was like, hey, Drew, do you love me more than these? The answer would be yes from him, but the idea is that it might be uncomfortable if it were no, just to randomly call someone out and say, do you love me more than these? And as you dig in your research, many people think that maybe when Jesus was saying these, he was talking about all the fish. There's 153 fish. That's a lot. But do you love Jesus more than fish? Anybody? Anybody choose fish over Jesus? Okay. That's fine if you do. I just want to get it out there. The idea is that there's a strong chance that Jesus wasn't talking about fish. That's an obvious and easy choice, just like the choice Drew would make. It's an obvious choice. Not fish, it's Jesus. The other people maybe believe that he's talking to the other disciples. Can you imagine how uncomfortable it would be to be in a room full of guys and Jesus go, do you love me more than the people around you? That'd be uncomfortable. I mean, the answer might still be yes, depending on who's around you and how much you like them, but it's still very uncomfortable. It's pitting people against one another. See, here's what I believe, and I spent quite a bit of time looking and reading over this passage, and here's what I believe to be what Jesus was reflecting on. When he says these, I believe he was maybe opening his hands. He was sort of pointing to everything. I think it's both the disciples and it's the fish, because the fish represent money, economy, jobs, stability, security. His friends represent accountability and relationships. See, I think Jesus was looking at Simon saying, do you love me more than the life that you have, more than the life that you're living? And are you willing to step out of the life that you're living into a life that only I can give you? I think Jesus was saying, are you ready to move? Are you ready to move? Do you love me more than the life you have? See, I think a lot of us look at our lives and we don't have bad lives. Actually, many of us, we have pretty good lives. In fact, if you don't feel like you have a good life, we can find people who have a worse life, and you can feel like you have a good life. The idea is that many of us, we don't have a bad life, but we might not be living the life that God has intended for us. What if we're selling ourselves short of God's best by living in what we've received or we've expected? Fishing for a living, catching 153 fish and hanging out with a couple of guys sounds like a pretty good job. That sounds like a pretty good career until you begin to realize that God had more in store. See, here's what I know about every single one of you, is that it doesn't matter who you are or what you've done. I believe wholeheartedly that God has more in store for us than the life that we're living. That there's a life just waiting for us beyond where we're able to trust God. And he wants to compel us and draw us into that life. He wants us to move. It's possible that Jesus was drawing Simon out of the life he was living. You don't need to worry about all of this stuff. Just trust me. Just move. His vocation, his habits, his friends, lay those aside and step into a relationship with me, because that's what love does, is it moves us. Jesus was asking if he was willing to walk away from the life that he had. But I have to wonder if you were, if Jesus were right here in this space, and I believe in presence he is, but if he's here and he's speaking to you, and he's looking at you and he's saying, do you love me more than these? What would the these be in your life and mine? What would he be pointing to? Do you love me more than this? Do you love me more than your vibe? Or do you love me more than your career? Do you love me more than your relationships? Do you love me more than the comfort and conformity that we've been living with? Do you love me more than these? What is the these in your life? What are the things that are preventing us from following God and living the life that he's called us to live? What are the things that we love more than God that are keeping us from stepping in to the ministry opportunities that he has for us? That I believe this to be wholeheartedly true is that it's less that we're looking to be loved and more that we're looking to find out if we're worthy of being loved. If you think about it, it's less that you want to be loved and more that you want to feel worthy of being loved. And everything that God has ever done was to show you that he loves you. And everything that Jesus has ever done was done to show you that you are worthy of being loved. And it's the moment we receive this worthiness, that we are worthy of being loved, that we're able to move, that we're able to transfer. And I believe in this moment on the beach, Jesus was reminding Simon Peter that you are worthy of being loved, but do you love me? And in his response in verse 15, it says, yes, Lord, he said to him, you know that I love you. Jesus says, feed my lambs. In verse 16, a second time, he asked, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Yes, Lord, he said to him. You know that I love you. Shepherd my sheep, he told him. I think it's fascinating that each time Jesus asked Simon, do you love me? He followed it up with feed my sheep. He followed it up with feed my sheep, take care of my flock. Whatever version you read, he follows it up with action. What I love about this passage is that he was inviting Simon three times to move. Every time he said, do you love me? He said, yes, Lord. Then he followed it up with a call to action. See, what I love about this passage is that so often as Christians, we think that our relationship with God is this self-indulgent relationship that's all about me. Do you love me, God? I love you. I love you. No, I love you. No, I love you more. No, I love you more. You hang up. No, you hang up. I love you more. And this conversation between me and God, it's just me and God. And he loves me so much. And I love him so much. But what happens in this moment is that Jesus, the second he becomes the object of our love and our affection, he ends up dispensing that love to everyone. He's not asking, do you love me so that it can be a one-on-one relationship? He's saying, do you love me so that you can go out and love other people as well? And I despise this idea that all we need is God. We don't always need, we need God, no doubt. But it's the moment we receive God that we end up giving God to everyone around us, that it can't be this self-indulgent personal relationship. It has to be something we share in tribe and community. It's something that we dispense to the lives of others. And God wants us to know that he loves you. But I believe it's abundantly clear that he doesn't need your love. I don't read this and go, man, he's begging Simon to love him. Many may read this and go, oh, wow, he's really pushing it here. Do you love me? Yeah, do you love me? Do you love me? Come on, man, do you love me? Like he's begging Simon to love him. I don't believe that Jesus was begging Simon to love him. I believe what Jesus was doing was he was reminding Simon that he doesn't need his love as much as Simon needs God's love, as much as you and me need to love God. We need to love God. And in return, we know that God loves us, but it's only when we're able to receive that love that we can give that love to the people around us as well. And so he's begging, he's saying, please understand that you need to love me, that you need to love me because you and I benefit way more out of following and loving God than God does. We are the great beneficiaries of the ability and the opportunity for the Almighty to allow us to love him. And he's saying, do you love me? He follows us up and he says, feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Do something with that love. Don't just be content with loving God, but do something with it. Don't just be changed by love. Be moved by love. It's not enough for us to gather in rooms like this all over the country and praise God. We love doing that, and I love doing that. And it's critical, and it's vital, and it's important. And I try to read my Bible as much as I can, and I pray, and I talk to God as much as I can. It's critical that we do those things, but it's not enough. It's not enough to be changed, but we must be moved. And when the passage begins to talk about feeding my sheep, what we've done as a church culture at large, the church in the big word, capital C, is that we have taken this feed my sheep to go, well, we need to eat more. And so you come into rooms like this and we go, hey, I need to be fed, so feed me, David. And we go, leave here, and we go to the next one, and we go, feed me. And then the moment you don't feel like you're being fed in this environment, you go to another one. And the moment you don't feel like that Bible study works, you find another, or that Bible reading plan, or if you've ever opened your scripture and it just didn't speak to you, so you find another one, because we've taken feed my sheep to mean that we're sheep and we need to eat. But what's interesting about this passage and the time period and the context in which Jesus is speaking is that there is no way that this could be translated into feed other Christians, because there were no Christians. There were no formative copies of the scripture. There was no possible way in context for Jesus to mean, go teach other Christians in a church-like setting. That what he was actually saying and referring to is, go out and find people who don't have love and show them love. Go out and find people who don't have hope and go show them hope. Go out and find people who are void of compassion and go show them compassion. When Jesus says, feed my sheep, he's not saying start a church. He's saying, go love people who aren't in a tribe like this one. Go find people who don't know me, who don't understand love and compassion, and go feed them. It's not that we're not supposed to eat, but when Jesus gives us the direct command to go feed my sheep, he's not talking about gorging ourselves, stuffing ourselves, and then vomiting it up, and then spending the rest of the week not eating, and then coming back again Sunday and eating as much as we can like a Chinese buffet, and then getting sick and vomiting it up, going all week without eating, and then starting again. He's not describing this bulimic process. What he's describing is for us to keep filling ourselves with God's love, but dispensing it the moment that we're filled. That it's not a thing where we just keep stuffing ourselves, but that we're always giving away. Feed my sheep. And in verse 17, he asked him a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved that he asked him the third time. Do you love me? He said. Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Once again, Jesus says, feed my sheep. Now, it's a little bit confusing because when Jesus is talking to Simon, he's calling him Simon. But when the author is writing the response from Simon, he's using the word Peter. And if you go back through the scriptures and the time that Jesus was spending with the disciples, you find that Jesus actually changes Simon's name to Peter, and he calls him Peter the Rock, that he is calling Peter to more. He says, you are the rock. And so from that point forward, Peter was known as the rock. But when Jesus shows up and he finds Peter living his old life, hanging out with his buddies and fishing, he calls him Simon. That it's possible that Jesus was addressing him for the way that he was living, not the way that he had called him to live. That it's possible that Jesus was calling him to more, but he was using the name in which his actions were attributed. That I think Jesus is calling us to more, but I don't want him to call me by my old name. I want him to rename me. I want you to be renamed. I want us to be the rock. I want us to be the one that God is calling to more, and we're stepping into more. That Jesus wasn't asking Simon if you love him because he wasn't sure. What's interesting is he spent three times asking Simon, do you love me? Because he wanted Simon to never forget it. If you remember Jesus' crucifixion, Simon denied Christ three times. Jesus is calling him back, reminding him, you love me. You love me. But God's love is not enough for us to hold on to, but it's us. It's enough to move us and to compel us and to propel us. And in John 21, verse 18, it says, I assure you, when you were young, you would tie your belt and walk wherever you wanted. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will tie you and carry you where you don't want to go. He said this to signify by what kind of death Peter would glorify God in. After saying this, he told him, follow me. Now, what we know about Peter's life is later on, he's found in Rome and he's crucified. Many believe he was crucified upside down with his arms stretched out, that Jesus was prophesying his death. But I think more than that, Jesus was telling him the cost of following me. He was telling him the cost of feeding sheep. He was telling him what it was going to take and the price that we were going to pay to do what he was asking us to do, follow me. But we know that Peter followed Jesus. We know through history that Peter followed Jesus all the way to Rome, and Nero was the one that punished him and put him to death, that he was doing the Lord's work, that he changed his life, that he shifted and he shaped and he changed and he moved and he did what God was calling him to do all the way to the point of his death. But that's what it costs. That I think it's important for us to understand that when Jesus says, follow me, it comes with a cost. It comes with a reward. And it comes with power and boldness, and it comes with a lot of advantages, but it also is going to come at a cost. There are going to be these things that we're going to have to walk away from in order to pursue God. So what are those things for you? What are those things that you love more than you love God? He's looking at Peter and he says, follow me. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep and follow me. But see, Jesus had to ask him three times. I got to wonder, how many times does Jesus have to ask us to shake us out of living our old life? How many times does Jesus need to call out to us, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Do you love me? Feed my sheep. How many times does he need to reach out to us before we understand the importance of loving God above everything else? Do you love God more than anything? If so, how is it moving you to action? What action is it moving you to? What is love compelling you to do? What sacrifices are you making for love? We know that Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice. That wasn't a question. He gave his life. But he did that because he would not allow us to settle for less when he knew he has called us to more. That I believe Jesus gave his life to prove that he loves us, that we are worthy of being loved, and that we in return can now love. See, love's not a limited quantity. It's not a depletable resource. It's endless when we ground our ability to love others in our ability to love God. It's never depleted. And you may feel tired and worn out, but the moment you connect your life with God, he begins to fill you and inspire you and empower you to love others in a way that you never thought you could love him. So how has love moved you? Who are the beneficiaries of God's love through you as a conduit of God's great mercy? What have we been invited to step into? What opportunities present themselves for us to show God's love, to do the work that God's called us to do? What areas of our life are we waiting for someone to step in and do something when God is waiting for you to recognize you're that someone? Let's move. It's time to move. That he will not allow us to settle, but he will keep calling and compelling and drawing us to live the life that he's called us to live. But he's a gentleman and he's not going to force you. He's going to wait. He's going to wait. He's going to wait for you to decide that it's time to move. So let's move. How has love changed you? But how has that change reflected in your movement, in your life, in your mannerisms, in the way that you spend money, in the way that we behave, in the way that we act with around one another? How is that love moving us? And what areas do we have to change? If you would go ahead and bow your head and close your eyes across the room.
For more information on our church and how you can support the ministry, you can visit us online at hamiltonlifechurch.com. Thanks again for taking a listen. We hope you enjoyed the podcast today.